So let us look into the something more advanced from the crystallographic point of view. So I'm going to describe the Miller indices, and it's a system, you know, which describes in which direction, in which angle, how much length you are taking to describe one atom from the other atom. So it's a vector quantity. By vector, what we mean is it has got both direction and length, and now both the values are very important, because you know, you can see that these three points, you know, are a vector quantity, and then these three will have different values. But in a scalar quantity, which is opposite of that, these two will have the same values, because they are in the, either you take the direction or you take the length of the, then length of the particular arrow. So magnitude means, you know, how far it goes. Magnitude, this is a small magnitude and this is larger magnitude. Suppose if you move from one atom here to another atom, then with how much direction and how much distance you are moving is very important. Okay, now this depends on the radius ratio which you have seen in the previous session. Okay, so however, I'm just going to the next, because these are all not very essential. Note that the direction is written as UVW, if you can have three directions, one in this way, the other in this way, and the third one in this way, so you can call this as Z, X, and Y. So that is what is being mentioned as U, W, U, V, and W in a crystal family. Okay. Even though they have the same XYZ coordinates, but we just write it as a U, V, W. Use a bar above the index to indicate a negative orientation in that direction. Negative orientation. This will be X. Something which is coming opposite will be X minus, it is indicated above that. And something which goes like this will be Y minus. Directions are crystallographically equivalent if the atom is spacing along the direction is the same. That is, if we have equivalent distance, equal atoms, we call each all atoms are equal. For example, in a cubic system, 100, 010, 001, 010 are all equivalent. We denote this as 100 or a family of 100 plane. I'll explain what is 100 plane. Suppose if we have an atom in this X and no, it doesn't go into X plane and that doesn't go to the Y plane, this you will call it as the 100. Okay. Now you just change this atom, you remove this and put it here. Again, this becomes a 010. This is gone. Now you remove this and put it along this. This becomes a 001. So in all the directions for equivalent atoms, this has the same meaning, but they are all relative only. Means in which directions you see, which you consider as x-axis, you have to define at the beginning. That is what we write in every graph as something as an origin, as 0, 0. And here you can write origin is equal to some atom like Na, Na. Suppose if you have sodium chloride cell and Na, 0 or something like that. So here are the, again, some 7 basic crystal lattices and slightly some changing in the directions of that and packing pattern. This happen to be the 7 basic, you can see that orthorhombic, base-centered orthorhombic, right? And this constitutes a packing pattern. So the other day I told you, we can have a tetrahedra. You can have a tetrahedra embedded in a cube, and you can have this cube as hexagonal close packing. Suppose, for example, how you get a tetrahedra is, I'll just tell you, make an atom here, okay, and then leave this, put an atom here, and then leave this and put an atom here, and leave this and put an atom here. Now you join these atoms, you know, through the center point. If this is a center point, you can draw a line here, you can draw another line here, you can draw another line here, and you can draw another here. So this is a cube, but these four atoms, that you have drawn are going like this, somewhere like this. Okay. This is the center point there. Okay, these are all the atoms. So these corners, one alternate corners, they form a tetrahedra. And this is what I tell you, that the tetrahedral can be embedded in a cube. And likewise, if you just see, you just rotate this along these pair directions, these two angles will come up your points like this here at these points, and then they will become hexagonal force packing. Okay. So these are the derivations, the derived crystalline formats, and you know the basic seven crystals, you know, within them you have got so many packings are all changing that. This will be given the names as 100 and 10010 plane. So the crystallographic plane, one can index a crystallographic by the following procedure outline. Find the intercepts of the plane in the crystal axis and express these intercepts as integral multiples of the base set. Intercept appadina something which disturbs. Suppose if you have a line like this, you want to draw a line, if you have an atom here, this is the intercept. Okay, now you have some chlorine and chlorine and you want to define a lattice that is getting repeated. This intercepts here, and what he is telling is it is told that this will be taken as a, some integral value. Okay, integral value, and in a crystal this distance which you take it as x has to be repeated at every place x. If it is x.1 or x.2, then it is not a perfect crystal. That is what is being said. Okay, then take the reciprocal of these integers found in step 1 and reduce this to smaller set of integers, HKL. Suppose if you have a intercept as, suppose let me just take 2, 3 and 4. I will just have to take reciprocal of this 1/3, 1/2 and 1/4. And then that will be called as the HKL plane. This is just a kind of notation. Notation. No, it doesn't have any scientific theory or background, it's just a way how you have to describe these inverse things as HKL, and that will be called as the Miller axis. So if you have an idea up to this, and it's okay, no need to go into more details about how Miller indices are there and how you have to define a crystal. Just some units that gets repeated, give it some integer value. Note that it is not a real value. So real value means, you know, it will be having something like 9.1, 9.2 like this. So it's an integer, so it's a something like a positive number. You can just describe it as 1, but it has to be repeated. And once it gets repeated, you have to inverse it. That value, you inverse it and put reciprocal of that will give you the HKL indexes. So that's all. The intercept means, you know, you have to disturb in between. The intercept is a particular axis, is infinity for plane parallel to that axis. That is what it is telling is, if you have a parallel axis, it will never intercept. Two lines never intercept, right? Two parallel lines never intercept. But one line like this, another line like this, you know, perpendicular, the interception point is here. So that is being mentioned there. So wherever intercepts, you may have several lines in this, this way, this way, this way. So wherever you have intercepts, you know, that is given in a particular plane, that is taken as H. In the next plane, it is taken as K. In the next plane, it is taken as L. Provided it is a reciprocal of that. If the plane contains one of these axes, it is parallel to this and is a zero reciprocal. So you don't remember this. You don't need to go this. But I am just trying to meld. There are many places where the HKL indexes, HKL things are mentioned. Note that individual plane is written as HKL and a family of plane is written as this flower bracket HKL. So a lot of things are there. If you write like this, H, K and L, it's a family of, rather I say some empty integers, you have different integers, family of planes. Then use a bar above index, use a bar to indicate the crystallographic unit of the atom spacing along each direction. For example, a cubic system, 100, this is x axis alone, this is y axis alone, this is z axis alone. One atom is present in the x axis, one atom is present in the y axis, one atom is present in the x axis, no atom in the y axis, no atom in the z axis, no atom in the x axis, no atom in the z axis, no atom in the x axis, no atom in the y axis are all equivalent. We denote this family as 100 and a family of 100 plane. So whether it is 100 or 010 or 001, we call it as a family of planes. This is essential, but you just are dealing with the nomenclature, so it is enough if you remember the nomenclature alone. Now comes to the next part. So I now we are now thorough with the indices, that is the points present in the lattice, inverse it, and the integers are taken and called as the HKL indexes. Okay, now the most important part now is called as the crystal defects. A crystal defect with a volume of 1 cm³ or 1 cc or 1 ml will contain about 1023 atoms. So it is only about, it is difficult to arrange that many atoms periodically in 3 dimensions. Now that it is very difficult to arrange these many atoms without any mistakes. The mistakes or defects are commonly present in crystalline materials. These are 3 types of crystals which are outlined below, so I am just telling you. Now, why do we study the crystal defects? You can see that if you have something very, very equivalent, you know, okay, something which is very ordered like this, okay. I am just trying to tell you why crystal defects are very important. If you have an order and you put an electron there, it is not allowed, because wherever there is order, there is a very less entropy. Okay, outside electrons will not be allowed. Outside electrons will not be allowed. எங்க ஆர்டர் ஒழுங்கா இருக்குதோ அங்க வந்து அதுக்கு ஆப்போசிட்டா இருக்கிறதுக்கு விடாது. சப்போஸ் இஃப் யூ ஹேவ் இஃப் யூ ஆர் சிட்டிங் இன் பெஞ்சஸ் இஃப் சம்படி கம்ஸ் அண்ட் ட்ரைஸ் டு சிட் யூ வில் நாட் அலோ இட். சேம் திங் ஹேப்பன்ஸ் ஹியர். ஸோ தி எலக்ட்ரான்ஸ் ஆர் நாட் அலோட் ஹியர், தேர் எலக்ட்ரட் டு மூவ் ஹியர் அண்ட் தென் திஸ் லேட்டிஸ் வில் நாட் அலோ இட், இட் வில் மூவ் ஹியர் அண்ட் திஸ் லேட்டிஸ் வில் நாட் மூவ் ஹியர். ஸோ லைக்வைஸ் அண்ட் எலக்ட்ரான் வில் கீப் ஆன் மூவிங். வென் இட் கீப்ஸ் ஆன் மூவிங் it constitutes electricity. That is to say that if you have a perfect crystal, you induce some defect and make it electrically active. That is the reason why we have studied the crystalline and we grew that. Okay, now there are 3 types of defects. One is the point defect, the other one is the line defect, the third one is the planar defects, that is trying to classify here. And some examples are given. A very pure crystal absorbs at least almost impurity that is available. Okay, substitutional solid solution. Okay, in the place of sodium you just substitute magnesium, only 1 or 2 or 3 or 10 atoms in 100, then it is a substitutional solution. Interstitial solid solutions mean, interstitial stands for something in between or within the space, or within two layers. As I told you in the previous case, that you know, in whatever in between these two layers is not allowed, the electron will be pushed back and this electronic moment will constitute electricity. Therefore, a crystal defect is found to have electrical property. Then you have specific Schottky and Frenkel defects that we are going to see in the next session. Okay, and then these are all the point defects. By point defect you can mention these two, Schottky and Frenkel defects, that I am going to explain the next by my next class. The next part is a line defect. So it is called as edge dislocation and discrete dislocation. They also have got a very good description, and that also I will explain in the next session. But you have to remember these two things, edge dislocations. As I told you that if you have the a cubic system, this will be called as the edge. This will be called as the edge. And this will be called as the corner. And this will be called as the face. Okay, so you have edge dislocation, corner dislocation, but edge dislocation both are having the same. Screw dislocation means, you know, you can have a layer of lattice and suddenly, you know, what will happen will be, this layer will not be consistent with another of layer. So you will have some 2 or 3 and a next layer will be there. I'll explain that also. It's of a type, it comes like a screw when you move from one direction to another. That is, it is a directional change is there. Okay, in one direction you can see all, suppose if you have a crystal of 10 planes, you know, you move the cube, the next phase, you know, have it may have 10 planes, but the next may have 11 planes. Okay, so that is called as the screw dislocation. And then planar defects is due to the grain boundary. Grain is, you know, something which is which has got literal meaning, that the grain is powdered, that is a mine substance, you know, which escapes from a particular bound, which escapes from the boundary part of that particular crystal. a simple part, a simple particle is missing that gives rise to the kind of effects. Okay, so it's a two-dimensional one. We'll see how it is, but for your syllabus you have only Schottky and Frenkel effects. However, I'll discuss edge and dislocations briefly so that it is also very essential for you to understand the defects in crystalline, then the properties. So in the point effects are concerned with imperfection on atomic scale. Atomic level of the change of it. There are about 1023 atoms in 1 cc of crystal. It's a standard thing. Okay, it is 1 cc of crystal, 1 cubic centimeter or 1 cc or 1 ml or 10 dl, whatever you want to say, this is a concentration. Even the purity of 99.99999.5% implies that the presence of some 1016 foreign atoms. Okay, that means, you know, it's a exponential one. Okay, I can understand this, but it's very difficult to explain how these 1016 foreign particles are there. What it's trying to say is the rest of that, suppose even if this is 99% of these atoms, 1% will be giving rise to 1016, because it is, you are taking in three directions. That is what is being meant there. So that three dimensions is what we call as the exponential. These foreign atoms will be larger are smaller than the atoms they replace. Furthermore, the foreign atoms may have different bonding capacities. In the place of one sodium, if magnesium comes, everything is changing. That is what is being done. In the substitutional solid solution, when two elements are added together, two elements, you know, it doesn't tell about whether it is solid or liquid or gas, they form a solute and can substitute for the parent solvent atoms in a crystal lattice. Note that this is a solvent. The solvent, solute plus solvent is there, that gives rise to solution, right? So there are some mixing of the elements is taking place. So what happens is solute goes in the place of the solvent. That is what is meant. Usually solvent will have very ordered pattern. They will not be getting substituted. But what is happening is solute atom just goes and displaces the solvent atoms. It is like a displacement reaction. Okay, the crystal structure of the parent atom or the solvent is unchanged. Crystal structure, this does not change. Outside appearance, you know, appearance also doesn't change, you know, appearance doesn't change. But when internal atoms, you know, they just change. Okay, appearance do not change, but the lattice may be distorted by the presence of the solute atoms. Lattice mattum konju lesa bend avum, ondu bend achina adukadathu appadiye bend avum. So it will be constituted one kind of a defect there. Okay, so all these defects carry the tag that they become a conducting property when some impurities. If you have a pure crystal, it is of no use. That is, having no electrical and magnetic or optical properties. Okay, the next part is the interstitial solid solutions. When the solute atoms fit into the spaces between the solvent of the parent atoms, suppose I'm just putting a layer like this. Okay, so this is surrounded by some other layer like this. Okay, so an atom that goes and sits here in that place will be called as the interstitial space. So that interstitial space within the solid unit is called as the interstices or interstitial site. This is very important and is often you will find these things in that. Okay, so I'll stop with this. We'll go to the Schottky and other defects and line defects in our next class. However, Schottky defect and Frenkel defect I'll discuss later. But let us just have a look into the line defects. You know, the line defects are often. So let us just I'll just here I am just discussing the points which we missed. You know, line defects are often referred as dislocation. Okay. Dislocations are created during solidification. That is why during crystal preparations you always give some mechanical steering. Okay. And scratching the sides or putting some foreign particle during the growth of that. Okay, if you don't do this, the actual this thing doesn't form that. But that is what constitutes the crystallographic techniques, where you have to grow crystallographic techniques. You know, in Anna University in Chennai, you have that crystal growth center. What do these people do? They take up the challenge and they grow the crystal. For that, they study the property of the element and they try to bring out the purest form of the substance without any defect. That is also very important for the material property, but for the electrical property, you will have to know the dislocations. So here you can see that there are so many generated when the solid is deformed. They may be also be generated when the solid is deformed. There are two types of dislocations, edge dislocation and screw dislocations. Let us look into the picture of that. See, this is one. This one is edge, you know, has moved up. So the edge, this is your edge. This is your edge, right? So the edge is going very well, but what has happened is with the formation, it has been dislocated. The edge has moved to this particular piece. So this distance, you know, is giving you the defect of that. Okay. So in the other type of dislocation, that is the screw dislocation, here you can see that something has gone into this particular spaces. The distance between this and this are same. Okay, but in between there is some swiveling, some bending of that, the parabolic type of that. So these two have given rise to another lattice growth in between that, but these distances are also the same, only at this particular point, you know, that will be the sharpest. So this particular point goes on increasing slowly, the next point, next point, next point, next point. So that is why it is called as the screw type, you know, as you see is screw there. But after a few turns, you know, they become normal. What happens in a screw? In a screw, you have only 2, 3, or 4 lines only growing in the size. After the fourth or fifth line, every line is uniform. That is exactly is what is happening at that. So a new layer is introduced there. New layer is introduced there. So that is why it is called as the screw dislocation. And this is also a property. It gives us a property to the crystallographic center. It is first necessary to choose arbitrary. Arbitrary na or temporary, something, you know, you can take. Arbitrary means, you know, it's a temporary positive direction. If the present case, let us assume the direction of the paper. Okay, so let us not discuss it. Just I have explained that is the same thing I explained here. Okay, when this is not in your syllabus, I'll just read it and then tell you what is happening there. Here it is. In the edge dislocation, it is being tilted. So this is taken as the plane of the paper. This is one axis, and this is another axis, and this is another axis. Okay. And these are all will be the integers. These are all with the integers. So suddenly there will be some change there. And the edge, you know, which has to go like this here, this direction, is going in these particular directions. Okay, so that is more clearly brought in here at this particular point, what has happened to that. So one good crystal is incorporated there. This is a compressed bad portion, and here it is there. So the size exponentially goes there. So this can even cause a kind of location called as the screw dislocation. So it just can give rise to screw dislocation, but if you have a zigzag pattern like this, it becomes a screw. Otherwise, it is just a plain display edge dislocation like this one. Okay. So this can edge dislocation can give rise to a screw dislocation, right? So that pattern you can see there. That is what is mentioned there, and the last part of the this session is that planar defects. Grain boundaries are found in polycrystalline materials. There are two-dimensional imperfections. It's a thing you have to remember. Two-dimensional imperfections that are created between two grains of different orientations. Orientation na, or different directions. Okay, orientation means, you know, different directions. The grain boundary is narrow. Remember, it is a boundary. This narrow region has about 2 to 5 atomic diameters in width. Very small. grain boundaries with more open structure have higher energy. It's a property. And are more favorable region for the nucleation and growth of the precipitates. So I told you, if you have a clear solution, if you have a clear solution and you grow crystal from that, or to grow crystals, you will need some nucleus. What is a nucleus? Some small particle or some salt. Okay. What do you do in cloud seeding? Do you remember the, have you heard of this cloud seeding? Cloud is a suspended water particle and charged particle above the earth. Now when these do not condense, they don't bring rain. Okay, so you need some salt. Just you have to put some salt there that acts as a nucleus. That nucleus form is what you call as the nucleation and growth. So around this nucleus, all the particles condense and then that brings the rain. So that is what is called as the cloud seeding there. Okay, so rapid diffusion, that low atomic packing in ground boundaries are also allows for more rapid diffusion items in the ground boundary. At ordinary temperatures, ground boundaries also restrict plastic flow by making it difficult for the environment distribution in the ground boundary region. So this is just a property unit number. I'll stop with this and we shall discuss about the Schottky and Finkel defects that is there in your syllabus in the next class. Thank you for joining me.